Friends, I welcome you to my channel. Before listening to this story, I will ask you to like and subscribe. It is not difficult for you, but it is pleasant for me. And we're starting. It seems like I've been working my whole life to make my wife happy, and it was a waste of time. It really hurts the guy to realize that all his efforts and intentions were in vain. After 23 years of marriage, I now realize that I did not know the mother of my children. She always wanted something better. No matter how hard I worked, it was never enough. She made me feel like I was a good supplier, and I always felt good when I could give her something, but she always wanted more. Sharon and I got married right after graduating from high school. Sharon had dark hair and wore it short. She was pretty and had a great figure. Our sex life has always been good until recently, and I had no reason to doubt her fidelity. I started with engine repairs, and today I'm a heavy machinery mechanic. I make damn good money, or at least I think I do. Our early life was pretty typical. Our first house was small, and when the children came, we changed twice. Now there are no two children. Our daughter Sarah got married, and our son John joined the Air Force. The house was bigger now than we needed, but she still didn't seem happy. My parents both died in a car accident many years ago. When the kids left, Sharon said she needed to do something, and of course that's where the problem started. She got a job at a real estate management firm. With the exception of a few secretarial-type employees, it was, in fact, a one-man firm, Glenn Sebastian, her boss. Of course, I met this guy. I didn't like him, and he ended up having an affair with my wife, even though he was married. It was at this point that I just decided to give up. What was the purpose of the sequel? My children grew up and my wife cheated on me. I made one last attempt. Sharon, since there are no more children, I would like to sell the house and move to Florida. How do you feel about this? I can get a job there and we can live a good life under the warm Florida sun. I'm going to pretend I didn't hear that. She didn't even look up from the morning paper. Our conversations were becoming less civilized every day. Of course, the problem was with me. I don't know how to use words, and I can't convince anyone of anything, because I just don't have the necessary language skills. Sharon put up with it because she was used to it. Glenn Sebastian was the complete opposite. He always knew what words to say and how to pronounce them. It was easy to understand how he dragged my wife into his bed. I think what I'm trying to say, Sharon, is that I'd like to get you away from Glenn Sebastian so I can get my life back. Charlie, Glenn is not going to disappear, and we have nothing to go back to. I'm going to keep working, and you're going to keep working, and we're not moving anywhere. End of discussion. Although I had evidence of cheating, I never told Sharon about it. She went about her daily business thinking that I was too dumb to understand what was going on. With $2,000 from my fund for a fishing boat, I received a detective report and photographs of everything that was happening. Sharon was still reading the newspaper when I left for work. I quit my job that day. Sharon was a lot of fun when we first got married. We went fishing together and I went to a few concerts to please her. We did little things to make each other happy. Children made our lives difficult, but we still always found time to entertain ourselves. As the kids got older, I seemed to work harder. I think that's when we started to drift apart. I wanted to save money for our retirement. Sharon wanted to enjoy the good life. She insisted on driving a BMW, which I felt we couldn't afford. It was easier for her to get it than to argue about it. No matter how hard I tried, I still couldn't keep her away from Glenn Sebastian's bed. I loved her, but I didn't like the way she treated me, so I gave up. Seymour Schlomp, my favorite lawyer, received the next $2,000 from my yacht fund. I gave him the detective's report and the photographs. I signed some blank forms, attached a power of attorney for the property, and told him to hand over the divorce papers next Monday. Sharon and Glenn had a motel day today. They went to the same motel, to the same room, at the same time, on the same days of the week. What Sharon found exciting about it was beyond me. They usually checked in around 11 and left at 2. I still had a few hours to prepare. Sebastian's holding company had many small buildings that they rented out, but the main income came from two old warehouses. Glenn bought them for pennies when the previous owners refused to bring the buildings into compliance with legal requirements. No one worked in the warehouses. They were just used to store goods and the like for various local businesses. I was willing to bet that Glenn hadn't even set the fire alarm. I spent 30 minutes in each warehouse setting up the equipment and then went to the bank. I have cleared a savings account, a checking account, and a money market account. After canceling the credit cards, I took all the money and put it in the luggage room at the bus station. It's time to start acting. It was a simple plan, to commit mass destruction and go to jail. I didn't understand how something could go wrong. I pulled into the parking lot of the Deska Motel just as the fire trucks were speeding down the street. There were two large warehouse fires on the other side of the city, and all fire departments were responding to them. Sharon's BMW was parked right next to Glenn's car. I parked my F-150 in the back of the parking lot and took out the tools of my new craft from the trunk, an emergency glass hammer, an aluminum baseball bat, and a pair of pliers. Accuracy and timing were important. At any moment, Glenn could get a call to tell him that there was a fire in his warehouses. I had to hurry. I set fire to a towel that I soaked in gasoline and put it in the gas tank of my car. I had to run as fast as I could because it only took a few seconds for the Ford to burst into flames. It wasn't a loud explosion like in the movies, but something like a muffled whistle. It seems strange to destroy your own car, but I didn't need it anymore. It took less than a minute to cut the valve rods from 8 tires. I took my time and went around every car, smashing every window with an emergency hammer. It worked well. The only problem was that Glenn's car alarm went off at the first impact. Before he realized what was going on, I started hitting the BMW with a baseball bat. To begin with, each panel was thoroughly smashed. The hotel staff and several people staying there were in the parking lot by this time, and it seemed that each of them had a mobile phone pressed to their ear. I was standing on the roof of the apartment when Glenn finally came out of the room, pulling up his pants. He was shouting something at me, but I couldn't make out what he was saying. I think he wanted me to stop banging on the roof of his car, but I wasn't sure. I went back to the BMW and started beating him up a bit more when the police finally arrived. Fire trucks were all over the city at the scene of a massive double warehouse fire, so they just had to leave my poor car burning to the ground. As the cops were putting me in the patrol car, I saw Sharon looking out the window of the motel room. I was framed, printed, and photographed within an hour. The photographer got angry because I refused to remove the smug grin from my face. It was nice to finally sit in my cell and relax. Since I pleaded guilty to everything that happened at the motel, there was no need for any lengthy courtroom drama like on TV. They mentioned something about warehouses several times. I told them I didn't know anything about it, and they soon stopped it. I'm sure they would have put it all together later, but right now they didn't have a good connection. As soon as word spread around the station about what I had done and why I had done it, everything seemed to get a little more comfortable. The next morning, Sharon was there with my deposit. There was no money in the account, so the only place she could get it was from Glenn or take out a second mortgage. I was pretty sure Glenn didn't want to contribute 10% of the $400,000. I could see Sharon through the glass partitions behind the cash register. She looked really angry. I knew that she knew that the accounts had been robbed. My watch, wallet, shoelaces, and money were returned to me. I was afraid to go out through the lobby, so I asked one of the guards if there was another way out to avoid a hostile wife. He chuckled a little, took me to the fire exit, held the door alarm switch with his baton, and let me out into the alley. Finally free, finally free. I took the cash out of the locker and bought a bus ticket to Chicago. I didn't have any place in mind, but there was an express bus going there. I had a lot of time to think while I watched the farmlands passing by the window. I was much worse off now than before, but my cheating wife no longer humiliated me. With my lifestyle, I had enough cash to last a couple of years, but I knew that eventually I would have to find some kind of job to keep from going crazy. I had no idea what to do with income taxes and Social Security. I didn't even know how I was going to get a driver's license, and I knew that sooner or later I would have to do it. After Chicago, I took several smaller routes that seemed to stop in every small town in the Midwest. I was traveling through the center of South Dakota when I found a newspaper left by someone. I was incredibly bored, so I started reading every line in the newspaper. When I came across the ads, I found myself reading the same ad 4 times. A mechanic for heavy agricultural machinery is required. Permanent residence. Housing, food, and salary depend on experience. Contact Leroy Summer. I've never even heard of Mitchell, South Dakota. Despite the fact that it was late summer, it was cold. The sky was gray, and the ground wasn't much more attractive. It looked like the perfect place to wallow in your misery. The Fairfax Equipment Repair Shop was located in a large steel warehouse-type building that resembled an airplane hangar. The sliding doors were actually large enough to accommodate the largest agricultural equipment. I never found out where this name came from, I think, from the previous owner. I had no problems getting a job. The living quarters were on the top floor of the maintenance building. It was harsh and not at all homely. The pay was low for this kind of work, and the mention of a boarding house meant that there was a kitchenette in the room. The best part of all this was my new roommate, Jorge. Jorge Toledo was born in El Paso, so he was not an illegal immigrant. He was a little older than me, but we had the same build and appearance. He wore his hair long in a ponytail, and he had a big mustache that hung down at the ends like Villa's poncho. I was clean-shaven, with short hair and glasses. I liked Jorge as soon as I saw him. Jorge worked in hydraulics and mechanics, and he was looking forward to hiring a machinist like me. It was the perfect team. He also had a Mazda truck that I hadn't seen in years. I think they stopped producing them in the 70s, but this one still drove, having traveled more than 300,000 kilometers. After a few weeks, I settled in and enjoyed my new life. We were both lousy cooks, so we spent a lot of time eating out, mostly fast food and stuff in snack bars. Jorge was an alcoholic. Leroy was not a strict leader. We could come and go as we pleased and watch the work being done. Leroy handled all the money and customer contacts, so all Jorge and I had to do was fix the broken equipment. We liked going to interstate truck stops and having breakfast late at night. Life was good. 4 months have passed. I was returning from the delivery, and Leroy and Jorge were waiting in the parking lot. They both kind of laughed when I parked the delivery car. "What the hell is so funny?" I tried to make the situation serious. "Well, we had a visitor today. A private detective from Philadelphia was looking for Charlie Terrell. Leroy seemed to be enjoying himself. Although George and I were quite close, our relationship with Leroy was maintained on a professional level. We were all close in spirit, but Leroy made great efforts not to become too friendly with the employees. It was easier for him to crack the whip if he kept his distance." "Oh shit, I was afraid this was going to happen. Was it from my wife or from the bail company?" "He never said. He also didn't tell me how he tracked you down here. Well, I think I'd better move on. Where is he now?" George started laughing, and Leroy's giggling seemed to spur him on. George was drunk again. "What the hell is going on? What's so funny about that?" George couldn't take it anymore. Leroy told the guy I was Charlie Terrell. The guy looked at the photo and shook his head. We talked for a while, and I told him that I'm illegal and bought a social security number and a driver's license from a guy in Denver. He was very angry, but the idiot never asked to see his ID. About 20 minutes later, he got into his car and drove away. "You guys are a good team. It's nice just to be with you." Leroy was still giggling as he walked back to his office. It was getting colder. Most of the work was now maintenance, not repair. There was no rush, and we could work at a good pace. The nights were getting longer and colder. The days were gray and depressing. I liked it. Jorge started drinking more. I had a break that weekend. When Jorge and I went into the bar at the Four Corners truck stop, I noticed a cell phone on the seat. Normally, I would just turn to the waitress and go my own way. But today, I had another idea. I told Jorge to order for me and left. I decided to call Sarah first. "Dad, what the hell are you doing in Tulsa?" "I thought I should call you and let you know that everything is fine." "That's great. We were worried, and Mom is going crazy." "What led to all this? Did everyone say you were crazy?" "What did your mother tell you?" "Just that you were unhappy with her job, and when she refused to quit, you went berserk and crashed her car and her boss's car. Is that all? Is that all she told you?" "Yes. After the bail was posted, she said you just disappeared. She hired a detective, but he couldn't find you. I think it cost her a lot of money. The next time you see her, ask for a more detailed explanation. She owes you a favor. She doesn't tell the whole story." "What are you doing in Tulsa?" "The subscriber ID indicates Tulsa." "I'm not in Tulsa, but I think the guy who lets me use his phone must be from there. Next time you talk to John, let him know that everything is fine. How's your mom doing?"
"You mean besides the fact that she was annoyed and embittered?
She lost her house after you refused to post bail, and she had to move into a mobile home on the highway. The insurance company refused to pay for the damage caused to the car, so she had to buy a car in the parking lot, which financed it itself. The BMW finance company is still demanding payment for the car. She works at a Waffle House near the airport and has to work extra shifts to make ends meet. Every time I talk to her, she curses you to the skies. Mom is unhappy." "Well, at least there's some good news."
"Dad,
you're sick. Are you going to tell me what's going on?" "Don't tell your mom that I called. If you want to know more about what's going on, you should ask her." "I think I understand. Call me again when you get the chance. I love you."
"I love you too, and I'm sorry I can't see you. While, I thought I had a few more minutes until my food arrived, so I called Seymour. Seymour, this is Charlie Terrell, what's happening? Oh, damn it, Charlie, you're in a world of shit. The bail company is looking for you. The cops and your wife are looking for you.
Wow. It's nice to be wanted, Seymour. How is my divorce going?
Everything is ready. Sharon grumbled a little, but eventually signed all the papers. This will be finalized in about 3 weeks if there are no complications. By the way, you don't have a home anymore. Yes, I heard that. Just curious, what is Glenn Sebastian's status? Mr. Sebastian left, disappeared from view. That's another thing that made your wife angry. I think she was looking for him to help her a little bit. And then he left town. It appears that he submitted fake reports to insurance and mortgage companies about the repair of sprinkler systems in his warehouses. The insurance company knew it was arson and he was the main suspect, so they refused to pay. Two people who had goods stored in his warehouses were also unable to get their insurance, and Glenn had to run for his life. By the way, I have to report this call to the police. You know that, right? That's what I thought. What are you going to tell them? That you contacted me from Tulsa to find out about the status of your divorce. Will it be okay? It's all right, Seymour. I would appreciate it if you didn't tell Sharon, however. When the divorce is final, will you be able to send the documents to my daughter? No problem. Take care of yourself, Charlie. I'm glad you called. By the time I returned to my seat, the waitress was already setting out the plates. Before we finished our meal, a monster trucker came to the table looking for his mobile phone. He seemed overjoyed to have his phone back and reluctantly agreed to take $20 when I told him I had made 2 calls. Everyone came forward, but I made Jorge pay for breakfast. He had to stop and restock his booze for the next week before heading home. It snowed and work slowed down. Leroy didn't mind, and Jorge and I spent more time relaxing. Jorge's drinking got even worse. I haven't had a haircut since I left home. Her hair was now long enough to be pulled back into a ponytail. To amuse myself, I grew a mustache. Every day, Jorge and I became more and more alike. Once, when he was half sober, I made him explain why he was drinking. I was married to a beautiful woman named Marisol. We lived in Waco. I had a good job and a beautiful house. One day Marisol came home and found me in bed with her sister. I hated her sister and never understood why I wanted to make love to her in the first place, but I did. Marisol threatened to strip me of my manhood if I didn't leave immediately. I loved her and have been drinking since that day to numb the pain of my stupidity. I would do anything to change what happened. At least I had an explanation. I wish he'd quit drinking or at least cut back on his intake, but he seemed to be trying to drink himself to death. I kept thinking about Nicolas Cage in that depressing movie. I was amazed that he did as much work as he did. My driver's license was about to expire. I didn't know what to do. I probably could have just gone and got new ones, but I was afraid they would notify Pennsylvania and someone would track me down. Jorge had a South Dakota state license, which was also subject to renewal. After endless hours of drunken debate, we decided that I would go and renew Jorge's license with my photo and signature. Jorge said he didn't want to drive anymore. No way. We decided that if I took off my glasses and combed my hair properly, I would succeed. I didn't think at all about what kind of trouble I'd be in if I got caught. By the end of the week, I was Jorge Toledo, and I had a driver's license to prove it. Jorge said that I should also start using his social security number. He wasn't hiding from the law, just from an angry wife who probably wasn't even looking for him. Jorge started drinking more and was unable to work half the time. Leroy knew what was going on but chose to kindly ignore it. Finally, about 2 months later, just as spring began, Jorge passed away in his sleep. He was only 45 years old. Leroy notified the authorities, and we organized the cremation that Jorge requested. What happened next surprised me beyond words. When the coroner came for Jorge, Leroy helped him fill out the necessary paperwork. I tried not to get in the way until they were done. After the coroner left, Leroy handed me a copy of the death certificate. At the top of the page was the name Charles Raymond Terrell. 3 days later, Leroy and I scattered his ashes to the wind. Since Jorge was not wanted by either the INS or the law, a wide range of opportunities opened up for me. Leroy was busy looking for a replacement until we got too busy. I decided it would be safe to get a credit card. I couldn't justify buying my own mobile phone. Leroy bought a few to use at work to replace old CB radios, and they had unlimited time and distance. I exchanged the Mazda for the 4th Ranger. It's time to call Sarah before she gets the bad news about my passing.
Dad, you're in South Dakota.
Isn't the caller ID great? Don't tell your mother. No way. I finally got her to admit why you left. I don't like her at all. By the way, the divorce papers came in last month. You're officially free. Unfortunately, I am also officially dead.
What the hell does that mean?
One of the guys at work died, and the coroner put my name on the death certificate. You'll probably get a notification soon, so pretend to be surprised and unhappy, but don't get too upset about it. You can tell John, but please don't tell your mother.
Wow.
This is certainly strange. I do not know how you did it, but I suppose congratulations. No one else should know about this. I hope the police and your mother stop looking for me. I was cremated and my ashes were scattered to all four winds, so no funeral or services are required. I think it's a good thing at a time like this that Grandma and Grandpa are dead. I'm sorry, I didn't have insurance for you. Don't worry about the insurance. We're fine and John's fine. He's just been promoted again and he's also back on the roster for another tour. Do you have a new name? Or is it better if I don't know it? Let's just say that your father is now an American of Mexican descent, and leave it at that. Dad, can Eric and I come and see you? I'm pregnant, and I'd really like to be with you. I know it's not good for you to go home, but can we come there? We have a new Subaru Outback, and Eric is dying to go on a trip. Let me think about it, and I'll get back to you next week. I don't see why not, but I don't have a place for you to stay. I live in a garage. I'm sure there are motels nearby. I'll be waiting for your call. Do not forget. I found a small motel nearby and notified Sarah. They'll be here in a week. Leroy still hasn't found a replacement for Jorge. That evening, I had breakfast alone again, and it was not nearly as pleasant as with my old friend. I thought about him on the way back to the garage and how sad he was when he died. I hated the thought of dying alone like this. Leroy was waiting for me when I arrived. He had a smug grin on his face, which meant he had a surprise for me. I wasn't eager to find out what it was. You have a visitor.
Who the hell would visit me?
Surprise. This is your wife. The earth stopped not because I was ecstatic, but because I was afraid of the coming moment. All the efforts and all the troubles were in vain. There was no way in the world that scum could have found me, and yet she did it. I walked slowly towards the workshop while Leroy was smiling from ear to ear. What the hell was so funny? I crossed the floor and went up the stairs. Without hesitation, I opened the door and stepped inside. Who the hell are you? In front of me stood the most beautiful girl I have ever seen. Her long black hair and dark eyes accentuated her Latin American features. Although she was well into her 30s, her body was 10 years younger. Her question caught me off guard, and I quickly realized why Leroy found it so funny. Marisol finally found Jorge, the man she kicked out 2 years ago, but never seemed to forget.
You're not Jorge.
Who the hell are you? Why did this nasty man send me here and tell me that Jorge would be here soon? I took a chair and motioned for her to sit down. As she sat down, her eyes never left mine, as if she didn't trust me. Do you want something to drink? No, just tell me what's going on. For the next hour, I tried to explain to Marisol how much Jorge loved her and how much he felt about what he had done to her. During the course of the story, I also had to explain how I ended up using his name and why. There was still some alcohol left, which Jorge hadn't finished, and we decided to help him. I do not know if we were commemorating Jorge's death or our suffering. She spent the night with us, and the next day we went to an open place where Leroy and I scattered the ashes. Later that day, she went home without the prize she had hoped to receive. She forgave his cheating, but she didn't have a chance to tell him about it until I opened a credit card account. I was grieving for her loss. I think Marisol and I made wild, passionate love at the end of the fairy tale book, but unfortunately it was real life. Sarah is coming to visit next week. At least I have something to look forward to.